Okay, let's sketch our perimeter for the object. And I'm going to start with a polyline tool. And a polyline lets you draw, and it'll keep adding on to the existing line. So I'm going to select near the point, and I'm going to run up to here, and I can zoom in. And this first part has some curves, but I'm going to keep it, I'm going to use straight lines until this point. And now I'm going to put a curve in here, so I'm going to end the polyline by right-clicking. And I want one more straight segment right across the top. And then the rest is going to be arcs. And you know, if you're familiar with the polyline, you can, as you're clicking, you can press the M key and it'll switch the drawing mode. So now I'm drawing a line orthogonal or perpendicular to the previous segment. I can hit again and it'll draw one that's tangent and parallel. Now I'm drawing an arc that is tangent to the line. Now an arc that's perpendicular, and it reverses and it cycles through. And so you can select these different modes to get what you want. But in this case, the way these arcs work, it was the polyline tool wasn't really behaving very well. It was always trying to run the arcs on the opposite direction. So I'm going to do these manually. So just selecting the arc tool, and if you kind of imagine this as one big circle, what you want is to kind of select about the center point, and then an endpoint. If you've already got an endpoint, you want it to light up so that they're automatically coincident. And then the end, the same thing, I'm going to imagine a circle here and go from endpoint to endpoint. And I got one more to do right in here. And it's about going to be in here. Okay, now my segments are in place, but they're not quite right. So you start dragging things around to make it look good. And I could mess around with this all day long or tell you to do it the way you like, but I start sounding a lot like Bob Ross. You know, make your own happy little batarang and do it the way that feels good to you. It's your batarang. Just make it the way you like. So I'm just going to get this kind of close. And if you were going for precision in another kind of model, you'd want to spend some time locking these coordinates down. It's not absolutely mandatory that you have a sketch fully constrained, especially for something this simple. But if you're going to be building on top of your sketches, modeling part of it and then adding features and then adding additional features, you definitely want to get your model as constrained as possible or fully constrained to avoid things breaking downstream. But in this case, my model is relatively simple and it's fairly organic in shape, and so it isn't absolutely critical that I get it locked. So I'm just going to get it close. I'm going to get my shapes about the way that I want them, and I'm only using the sketch here as inspiration. I'm not trying to absolutely match it. And so to me, that looks about right. So I'll close this, and then we will pad the sketch out. And if I pivot sideways, you can see 10 millimeters is way too much. So we're going to set it at 3, and I believe that's the thickness of the original material that I used when I made it. I had some 3 millimeter aluminum laying around, so we'll pad it to 3. And that will finish the half model. Okay, now that we've finished the half model, the next step will be to create the left side mirror and to add these chamfers to the edges. It's sort of like a sharpened edge on a blade, and so we'll want to chamfer these edges. And there's a couple different ways to do mirroring and chamfering in FreeCAD, and since we're already in the part design workbench, we're going to look at that one first. Okay, so there's a mirroring feature or a mirror tool on the toolbar, which if you hover over it will say create a mirrored feature. And it's important to note that what this is actually doing is trying to, like it said, mirror a feature. That means a part of the body. So we have a body, and it includes this series of features that have been built up from our sketch up to the pad, which is the tip of the body right now. So if I select the pad and do a mirror, normally if you were mirroring a feature, it'd be like if you had a hole or something, and you wanted to mirror that feature in this part of the body over to this part of the body, that's what that would be for. In this case, the tip feature that we have corresponds to the whole shape anyway. And so if I select this tip and use the mirror tool, FreeCAD will actually correctly guess the mirror plane, which is this YZ plane. It'll guess correctly, and if I say okay, everything looks like it's going great. So what I would want to do next is add the chamfers, but if I select a couple of these points or these edges and try to apply the chamfer, something kind of strange happens. My model disappears, and if I say okay on the dialog, I'll get an error that it failed to create the chamfer. And what's happening is Open Cascade, the CAD kernel, is having trouble with these two edges chamfering and meeting it at a point in here. It doesn't like doing that, and so it's failing. So the next thing you might think is, well, what I'll do is apply the chamfer first. So I'll select a couple edges and I'll apply the chamfer. That works. And then select the tip and try to create the mirror. And in this case, I get a different error. And it asks me to create a subtractive or additive feature first. Well, I kind of would have thought that the chamfer is a subtractive feature, but apparently it's not regarded that way. And so mirroring it doesn't work. It fails. I'm not able to create the left side from it. How do we proceed? Well, let's take a look at the mirroring feature in the part workbench and see if that can work for us. But before we do, I'm gonna tweak my chamfer a little bit. What I want is for this sharpened edge to come all the way down the full thickness of the material. So if I set this at 3 millimeters, you'll see that when I move it from 1 to 2, it updates, but it still leaves a little bit of material behind here. And if I go from 2 to 3, nothing changes. With the chamfer, it doesn't like removing the material entirely. It doesn't like going down to the fine edge. So if I go down to 2.99, that gets me very, very close, and that's close enough for me. Okay, so now if I switch to part workbench, I have a couple of different tools here, including this mirror tool as well, which mirrors a selected shape. So unlike a feature, this is creating an entirely new shape across a mirroring plane. So what I'll do is, instead of selecting the tip of the object or tip of the body, I'm going to select the body itself, and I'm going to create the mirror plane. And again, I have the choice of selecting the plane. It doesn't give me the helpful little indicator, plane selector, but I know that it's the YZ plane. So I'm going to select that, and I'm going to mirror my body and say okay, and I get correctly mirrored. I get my left half side with the chamfers as I want them. But what I did was I mirrored an entire shape. So I now have the mirror shape, which is the left side, and the body shape, which is based on the chamfer, which is the right side. And these are really two independent objects. They're nested in the tree here, but these two sides are not connected to each other. They're linked in the sense that if I come back into the pad and the sketch and I change some aspect of this, and close it, it'll automatically update the mirror. So the left side and the right side are still linked. If I were to change the dimensions of the chamfer, the left side would be updated for that as well. But the two objects, the two shapes, are independent. They're not part of a single solid. So what I want to do is I want to unify them. I'm going to use a Boolean union to do that. So I'll select the body and the I'm going to select the chamfer and the mirror so that both sides are highlighted, and then I'm going to do a Boolean union on this, and it's a union, and I'll apply it. And now I have an object called fusion in the tree, and if I select it, I get the whole thing, and it is still contains everything underneath it. So again, I could still drill back down into my original sketch, and I could change an aspect of my sketch, and both sides would be updated at the same time, just like before. Now I still contain this center line in here, and this won't cause any problems. Like if I was using this shape in the path workbench to cut a shape, this line won't cause any problems. But if it bothers you, or if you want to do something that you need to have it removed, you can do that very easily by selecting the fusion object, and on the part menu there's an option to refine shape. And if I do that, I'll get a cleaned up version of the shape. However, what it did was it hid my fusion object, and it created fusion 001, and these two objects are no longer connected. And my refined fusion shape is not connected to my sketch. So if I now needed to go and adjust my sketch at all, any changes I made would not be reflected in this refined shape. I would need to delete this, go back, change it, and then do a refine on it again. And that's really not a problem, but it's good to keep in mind what's happening there. Okay, so I now have a complete shape, and that should work for my purposes. In the next video, I'm going to set up a job in the CAM workbench path, and we'll set this up for CNC cutting, and maybe take it out to the shop and cut one. Stay with us.